I confess to the Lord. comfort all those who mourn, and to give them for ashes a garland. For mourning, Lord, the oil of gladness. For despondency, praise. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Neither a doctorate nor a Bailey nor anything medical.
a ready apparative arm. What he is receiving today is the affection of his people and the admiration of his peers. He is surrounded by his friends and his family. None more distinguished than his former classmate, Cardinal Winning, who will naturally be celebrating the golden jubilee of his own priesthood later this year. We take this opportunity of congratulating him in anticipation of that event. Monsignor John is giving thanks to God for the gift of the priesthood and for the 50 years in which he has exercised it with exemplary fidelity and fortitude. We are here simply to give thanks with him and for him. No one does so more gratefully than his bishop, to whom Monsignor John has been a trusted advisor and a loyal colleague over many years. The priesthood is a calling, a vocation. It is not addressed to all, but to those whom God has chosen. It is an invitation to share more deeply in the threefold character of Christ as priest, prophet, and king. Priest, the offerer of sacrifice, prophet, the announcer of the truth, king, the leader of God's people. The Catholic priesthood is not primarily a function, nor simply a task. It is a new relationship with Christ. It involves a deeper intimacy with him as shepherd of the flock. The priesthood is calling, vocation. The priesthood is gift. To the one who answers the call and is found worthy, the sacrament of orders confers the grace of the priestly state. We speak of the sacrament conferring a character, as baptism does, as confirmation does, as perhaps the bond of marriage does in the lifetime of the sacrament they can join. The grace of this sacrament establishes the one who is ordained in a relationship with Christ, a relationship which is real. Theologians will call it ontological, to do with the reality of things, and not simply with their shadows, their symbols, their promise. The priest is another Christus, another Christ. He bears the image of Christ. As every baptized and confirmed Christian is bound to do, as does the Christian husband and wife, in their reciprocal love. The priest is an altar Christus in the line of Christ's priesthood. He acts in his name, in the language of the theologian, in persona Christi, meaning literally in the person of Christ. Priesthood is giving. Priesthood is service. A man who responds to the call deep within him and places his life at the service of the Almighty undertakes the noble task. It involves personal sacrifice, the dedication of himself within the virginal or celibate estate, so as to be available to all as a father, a brother, a friend. It needs more love, not less, to fulfill this service. More availability, not less, to meet the calls made daily to God. To sum up, the priest is God. The priest is gift. The priest is service. The priesthood is also fulfilled. To know that one is needed, to receive the love which the faithful give, to have the satisfaction of knowing that one is acting for Christ as his ambassador, is one of the most fulfilling of human experiences. Despite the frustrations, the weariness and the loneliness which are inseparable from the task. Monsignor John experienced as a young man in the grace of Ben Livet the call to priesthood, and he responded generously. He was a student, nurse, then in Rome, and on account of the times, returned to continue his studies at home. He was counted worthy of promotion to the priesthood and was ordained 50 years ago by Bishop George Bennett at Blair's College Chapel, the 29th of June, 1946. He has served the Lord faithfully over 50 years, doing service at St. Peter's, St. Mary's, and at St. Joseph's Woodside in Aberdeen, at Braemar in Aberdeenshire, and at Port Sawyer and Keith in Banffshire. He has acted as Vicar General for 17 years, served as Dean for 10 years, and following the death of Canon Lewis McWilliam, has become part of the Cathedral Chapter. As regards fulfillment, Monsignor must bear his own testimony. All I can say is that wherever he has served as priest in the diocese, he has shown a deep sense of commitment, not only to the Catholic family, but to the whole community. He has shown every sign of being content in his priesthood, happy in the discharge of his priestly task, winning from all affection and respect. For this, we thank God with a full heart. We thank God the Father, from whom all good things come. We thank Jesus, his Son, whose priesthood is in your God the Shepherd. We thank the Holy Spirit, by whose gift our Jubilarian has been graced, and from whom we seek today that final gift of perseverance by which the crown of life is gained. Monsignor John, ad multos animos.
Gracious God, we thank you for those who provided him with time. tangible assistance, for those who rendered practical support, for those who gave them spiritual encouragement, for those who imparted wisdom and friendship. We thank you for such people who are still alive, who can take great satisfaction and joy in the knowledge that they have in some way contributed to making possible your servant John's achievements in your service to his people and to the whole wider community. And we thank you that for those who have passed away, yet they also, as part of the communion of the saints, are present now with us and rejoicing also at this golden jubilee. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear us.
We pray that you will grant your servants, Monsignor John, in the days ahead, health of body, mind, and spirit. In the autumn of his years, help him to enjoy the rich colors he has sown in the tapestry of life by the love and compassion he has shown to friend and stranger alike. In winter days, give him such strength that he will never weary of carrying the burden of your work. And may John be assured that all of us here will care for him in the same way he has done for us. Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Bless your church with unity and peace. Make her here and all over the world a true fellowship of the Spirit, in which no distinction is made because of race, of colour, class, or party. A fellowship of love in which all are really one in Christ. We thank you for calling us into the company of all those people who trust in Christ and who seek in their lives to do this work. And we thank you for the fellowship shared among the churches we keep and the closer links with all the churches in our country. You have made us strangers no longer, but pilgrims together on the way to your kingdom. Guide us closer to you and to one another in the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace, and strengthen us together in mission and service to your world. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear us.
And women of your choice, hear and heed your call through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Almighty and eternal God, hear and answer our prayer through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Oh.
claims dominion over all creation, that he may present to you his almighty Father, an eternal and universal kingdom, a kingdom of truth and life, a kingdom of holiness and grace, a kingdom of justice, love, and peace. And so with all the choirs of angels in heaven, we proclaim your glory and join in the unending hymn of praise.
Rise up, Lord, pray, thou didst glory of faith. Rise up, Lord, pray, thou didst glory of faith. Rise up, Lord, pray, thou didst glory of faith.
celebrate the memory of Christ, your Son. We, your people, your ministers, recall his passion, his resurrection from the dead, and his ascension into glory. And from the many gifts you have given us, we offer to you, God of glory and majesty, this holy and perfect sacrifice, the bread of life and the cup of eternal salvation. Look with favor on these offerings, and accept them as once you accepted the gifts of your servant Abel, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father of faith, and the bread and wine offered by your priesthood Israel. Almighty God, we pray that your angel may take this sacrifice to your altar in heaven. Then, as we receive from this altar the sacred body and blood of your Son, let us be filled with every grace and blessing.
Remember, Lord, those who have died and have gone before us to part with the silent faith, especially those for whom we now pray. May these and all the sleeping Christ find in your presence life, happiness, and peace.
For ourselves, do we have some share fellowship of your apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, and all the saints. Though we are sinners, we trust in your mercy and love. Do not consider what we truly deserve, but grant us your forgiveness.
Through Christ our Lord, you give us all these gifts. You fill them with light and truth. Bless them and make them holy. Of your kingdom where you live forever and ever.
Amen.
leave you. And I feel that's exactly what's been happening to me over the last few days. And I think it's still going to be doing another for the rest of this night. But I'm being led on, and I know there are other things that are going to be happening shortly. But again, I would like to say how what a great pleasure it is to be with you all here tonight. All who mean so much to me from other parishes and fellow clergy and fellow ministers of the church here in Keith. It's been a great pleasure for me to have been with you all. And as I say, during this Mass, I've been remembering all those who I have known over the years in various parishes living in there. But now I wish you all to be well and thank you all for very much for coming here this evening to join with me in this very special.
Congratulations.
Oh, it's wonderful to see you.
I'm really happy.
It's great to see you.
I'll go and get me back.
Thank you.
wondering, Isabel, if you want to draw their attention, just say, somebody's lost £10 note here.
A couple of years ago that we suddenly realised that this anniversary was looming large, and it was fortunate that we noticed when Monsignor was away on holiday, so we could get on with planning behind his back. We did frantic planning, and then of course when he came back, all had to go underground. And the things that happened was, you know, the good ideas came, some were developed and some were discarded. And there were secret meetings. People were found themselves bumping into the treasurer, not quite accidentally, and slipping him something with a sotto voce for the secret fund. we did all sorts of, there was meetings in special agents met in a dimmed room in a certain Speyside hostelry to exchange coded messages and secret packages and then to melt away into the night. So we've had a lot of fun doing all these things. Eventually, of course, we had to allow Monsignor to know a little bit because practicalities. And then, of course, there's always somebody who can't keep a secret. But at last, what has been known as the worst kept secret in the North can now be revealed. We still have a few surprises for Monsignor, and I think he'll enjoy them when he sees them. Now, I'm speaking on behalf of the Abelauer, the Dufftown, and the Keith congregations. We all worked together at that time. Changes were made later, and then Huntley became involved, and we're very happy to see a contingent from Huntley. They pipped us at the post and gave Monsignor his presentation last Sunday, so he still has hours to come. It's my pleasure now to welcome His Eminence Archbishop. Oh, no, not at all. Cardinal. His Eminence Cardinal Winning. We're very honoured to have him here. We pay due respect and deference to his high office, but in fact he's here tonight as a lifelong friend of Monsignor, and we'll hear from him in a moment or two. We greet our own Bishop, Mario Conti, from Aberdeen. He has already spoken to us and for us, and we thank you, my Lord, for what you have to say. Then we have here a very good friend of ours, Father Andrew Mann. Andrew is a Keith Loon, and a lot of us watched him grow up through what seemed to be an incredibly long chrysalis stage, and then he eventually emerged and was ordained as a priest. And we were happy and we joined with his parents in their pride and joy to see him now, and he's doing good works, and he's going to be allowed to say a little bit in a short while. One especially warm welcome I have to give to Mrs. Anna Doherty. She's somewhere in the hall, very modestly hiding. She's Monsignor's sister, and from time to time she leaves her home in Devon and comes up to stay with Monsignor. In the nicest possible way, she comes and sorts him out, helps him with his entertaining, and then leaves, leaving behind a generous supply of his favourite homemade marmalade. Just one other mention. We're pleased that Brian Donald, who is the congregant, was a member of our congregation for a long time, and for health reasons now lives in Spain. But in spite of his handicap, he's made the journey to be here tonight. Welcome, Brian. Enjoy your evening. And with that done, I'm going to hand over to His Eminence Cardinal Winning.
Senior Brother Bishop, Brother Priests, ladies and gentlemen. Great to kill, is it? No. Well, first of all, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to be here tonight and to be up here in the Northeast, and I couldn't help just being very nostalgic about this part of the country, because we down in the west, we stand in great debt to the northeast. We have a building, our office in Glasgow. One of the rooms is called the Scott Room, and the other, another room is called the Murdoch Room. I don't know why you're laughing. It's not after Celtic players. But both of these bishops, they were the first bishops in Glasgow following the, just before the restoration of the hierarchy, both of them came from the Inge up here in the northeast. And we've got an entertainer up good for the winter nights. In fact, another priest that I never knew him, of course, but my great-grandfather and great-grandmother came from Ireland, and they were married, on her father's side, they were married in Glasgow by another Inge priest called Father Geddes, who died at the early age of 27 after looking after the sick in one of the cholera epidemics in Glasgow. So I'm very happy to be here because I value the faith of the people up in this part of Scotland, and the bishop knows that because I've said it many times. But I'm also very happy to be here at Johnny Cope's 50 Lads. I was first introduced to the Northeast by Johnny 50 years ago, probably 51 years ago. And we had been in Mill Hill in a seminary there for a year. And when we came back, I think you went to Cardinal's. When you were ordained and after you were ordained, and I went out to Rome. And 50 years ago, and we're going back in October because the survivors of that journey 50 years ago to Rome to reopen the college after the war, I'm looking forward to October, the 18th of October, and I hope Johnny Crow has got enough money to come with us. So it's up to you. Now, I was seeing my office in the train coming up this afternoon, and there was a quotation from St. Paul. A quotation from St. Paul, which I thought was absolutely spot on about Johnny Cope. Whatever you do, St. Paul, remember, it's not his mother. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart. Now, is there anybody else that you could think of who does more of that than this fellow over the past? Work at it with all your heart as though you were working for the Lord. Remember that the Lord will reward you. You will receive what he has kept for his people, for Christ is the real master you serve. And that is Johnny's epitaph. Christ is the real master you serve. And I've got to correct something. I'm not celebrating my 50th anniversary of my ordination. I have a couple of years to go. If I were, I'd be the
retiring this year, he's probably going to resign my job. A couple of years to go, but we were in college together. Mgr Copland and the bishops, well, later on. I used to waken them in the mornings. Oh, the bishop. As the comedian in Glasgow says, you've got off a good whack of here. You know who I mean anyway, I've forgotten his name.
Jolly.
A.M. Jolly, yes. I was nearly saying Rennie Houston, but that's not Ricky Pulverton. What I was going to say about Monsignor Copland was that just struck me the other day to maintain your enthusiasm and your joy in your work for 50 years really deserves a bit of credit. And, you know, we can all grow tired, we can become disinterested, frustrated, kind of opt out almost. And that applies to the clergy as much as it applies to anybody else. But Johnny Cope has kept up that enthusiasm that he had when he fell off the roof. Fear's dead. He was up repairing the roof. And, you know, he probably thought he didn't need a ladder, so that's one of the memories I have. Do you remember that?
Oh, yes.
That's why they're scaffolding all in. He's moved from Aberdeen, and it's wonderful to listen to him, how he recounted his work, his ministry in these different places, Port Soy, Braemar. I'm sorry I left Braemar because I think it's a lovely spot. And Port Soy, and here. And he's been a real jewel in the crown of the Aberdeen clergy.
Yeah.
And I'm just very happy. I'm very happy to be here to bring him the best wishes of many of his colleagues who are down in the West who are celebrating the same anniversary, Golden Jubilee. I'll be spending the rest of the week and next week as well going around celebrating with them. And it was a big year, and they all were very fond of Johnny Cope. So I should like, just on behalf of all those clergy from all over Scotland who know him and who value his example, to say thank you very much and congratulations, Johnny, and blind me of Lumbly.
Can you hear me at the back there?
Oh, yes.
Just prepared a few words. I thought I picked up the bishop's sermon by mistake. You see, I've been on this stage before. And I think for me, the very eminent people here, I can understand why I'm here as a native of the town. The only clergyman here without a skirt on. I can remember most is the first time I met Monsignor John was shortly after I'd escaped from Blair's in 1974, and I was going on to Spain, and my mum and myself were in Aberdeen shopping, and we ran into him in the street. And of course the parish was vacant at that time. Canon Lamont had died and there was no priest here, so we were all speculating as to who would be taking over the parish. And I remember running into him in the street. Of course, my mum was quizzing him frantically to find out who would be. And I can remember he just smiled, rather a wry smile, and said, "Oh, you'll find out in due course. It won't be very long." Afterwards, we discovered it was him. I knew there was something there, she said. I knew he was hiding something. And I think Johnny has got something which perhaps is always very important among the clergy, because nobody else has it, and that is discretion. To keep a bit of a secret, and maybe that's how we become a Monsignor and a Vicar General. That's why there's only one. So the second thing I'd like to say is maybe a more personal thing. There's probably two occasions which I think have been in my memory about Monsignor John over the last wee while, and they're both what I would call a kind of roaming home. The first one was roaming to Rome for the canonisation of St. John Ogilvie in October 1976. When he organised the whole trip across, and I was in Spain obviously at the time when we flew over, and it's not mentioned in any of the things about the canonisation of John Ogilvie, but one of the miracles that wasn't really attested was how this bottle of J&B always kept him. Up Kelly or others, and they're going to me, would you like a wee drink? So he had his own personal supply, and he ensured that the Holy Father also had been given a supply to hide under his table. The second pastoral thing I think was my own ordination as a priest in 1980. If you think the fate of John Ogilvie was terrible, having to deal with my mother in preparation for the ordination must have been a fairly sore trial. I think my dad and Monsignor John were kind of soulmates in this exploit, and would have the same kind of ability to let the waves just wash over them as all the preparations were being made. So perhaps I think that's something else who's got that endurance able to keep going, and I put that down to what he's got in his hand just now, one of them anyway. And I noticed coming in, the new sign says Murray, Malt Whiskey Country. So I was going to put Johnny Cope's favourite. So a great preservative for clergy in this part of the world. So those are two things, memories that I have, I think, of him. And I'm conscious that those have been things where he has been a great friend and support over the years for me. And thinking over those 50 years, almost half of them, not quite, but almost half of them, been spent here at Keith. So it makes him one of the family here, one of really somebody who is part of the community.
A Keith Gard.
Hold us and our memories. And I think we all share those common memories together, things that are personal for me. Someone else will have something which Johnny reminds them when they see him, you know, of something that he's done for them. So I think that's the important thing, that we hold that memory ourselves as a community. John, tonight you are with your family, your sister Anna, but your family too of the parish and of the community of Keith. And we wish you again, Admiral's hands.
Not giving you the sack. But I ask you to accept this bag with its contents, and it comes with all our love, our continuing affection, and our thanks. It comes with the hope that you will use it on many happy journeys. Return to Keith. Oh.
Came back, got them to sign up things, and the marriage took place.
About 3 weeks or a month later, he asked me to get another wedding. And this one, I found out in the morning that there was no dispensation. And I phoned the cathedral to find that Monsignor Patterson was at Lurs. And it says a great deal for Monsignor Patterson's patience and everything else, because in those days he had to walk from Blair's, take the ferry over to Cults, get a bus from there. He didn't drive, he never did drive a car, and into the cathedral, signed up the thing, and I got the wedding going. Another wedding that I had in St. Peter's, and this was myself this time, it was one great. That's the bridesmaid. And to this day, it's still pleasant to me, because the bridesmaid was never saying a word. But what I learned from Canon Grant was his knowledge and understanding of people. That was really extraordinary. At lunchtime, he'd say, "Where were you visiting today?" And I'd tell him, he'd go through that family to the third, fourth generation. It gave me a great background of many of the people in Aberdeen, particularly in the travelling folk. So much so that when I was up in the cathedral, whenever the almoners in either the Sick Children's or Forrester Hill or Wood End or in the maternity had some of these travelling people, they used to phone me up and ask me if I'd given them the background. I remember one case where I happened to be in the Sick Children's at the time when one of the nurses said, "The almoner from the maternity is asking for you." So I went to the phone. She says, "Can you tell me something about the history of Mrs. So-and-so? I said, "Oh, I could." I said, "I'm not going to, because I've just given the same history to the almoner here, because the child is in the hospital here." So, as I say, I got a great knowledge of people through Canon Grant. It was his understanding of people, his humanity, it was so great. Then I went up to the cathedral, and Monsignor Patterson was a very different person. He was a person who had a great love of the dignity of the priesthood, and also of his love for his fellow priests and his respect for his fellow priests. Any priest that was in trouble knew that they would have a sympathetic ear from Monsignor Patterson. And between those two, they gave me a great knowledge of what the priesthood was always about, a dignity that was due to the priesthood itself, and the need to know your people. And I'm hoping that these things have remained with me during all the years of my life. I went from the cathedral to Portsoy, and Portsoy had a very small Catholic population, but Portsoy itself was such a friendly place. I'm quite sure that there wasn't a house in Portsoy and I couldn't just walk into it. They were so friendly. And they helped you in so many ways, and when you suggested anything, they were so eager to help you. And as we were going into the church tonight, and we saw the marble arch which had been put up this morning, and it reminded me of the open air theatre in Portsoy. There we used to put up such tremendous buildings, churches, castles, houses, and the rest, all done by the local people. And I'm very pleased that tonight, one of our chief actors in the open air theatre is here tonight. So I'm very, very pleased to see my old friend Jack Forsyth is here tonight.
Dramat. And Dramat I love too, because Raoul knew him in the hills. And I've always loved the hills. And there, of course, I got involved. There have been some tremendous tragedies in the hills. And at that time, what happened was that the policemen, when they heard of someone had fallen or there was an accident in the mountains, the word got to the policeman. He went round a few people in the village, and off they set, more or less just with the clothes they were wearing. But it came to a stage where it was particularly the case where the three cadets were lost. And John Duff, who was the policeman at that time, came to me and he said, look, we'll have to do something about this. He said, we can't go on in this way. I said, right, we'll call a meeting of the men of the village for tonight. And we did. And we immediately started up the Vermont Mountain Rescue Association. And then with the help of, I must say, of Chief Constable Chassa, who backed us all the way, in spite of certain opposition from a couple of the Aberdeen Mountain Rescue teams, because they were afraid that if we set up, then their funding would go down. But in fact, when they heard that we were setting up, they more or less ordered us to come into Aberdeen and state our case. And one of them began, first of all, and said, this is a job for trained mountaineers. And they went on in that vein. And well, one of the group that I brought in, I said to him, I think Davy Rose would like to say a few words. So Davy began and he said, I've been a ghillie, I've been a gamekeeper, and I'm now a nature conservancy warden. And he said, there's probably not a square yard of the Cairngorms that I haven't been over. But I don't consider myself a mountaineer because I can see no point of hanging on by your eyebrows to a ledge when there's a perfect easy way of getting up. First of all, I spoke to a group and they said that we wanted to do something. Then, with the help of two members of Styrenians from London came up, and with the help of students from the university, we went out on a survey. At that time, the police said there were only 8 rough sleepers in Aberdeen. Well, that night we found 38. And the two from London said, now you've found 38, you can be quite sure that the number is double. Well, when finally we did get a shelter for them, the very first night we had 70. So they were very accurate in the rest of the estimate of what was real need in Aberdeen. Then Bishop Quallen wanted his new Vicar General in Aberdeen beside him, and he asked me to come to Keith. And I came here, I was coming back to Manchester, and I've always loved my own native county. The sad thing, of course, is that now Manchester is not really on the map at all. I think it's a great pity, and particularly it has really no cultural links with Murray. Its links, if anything, are with Aberdeenshire. And it is a great pity that Bamshire has been absorbed, and even more so that Keith has been put in such a position that it doesn't know where it is. Because for one thing it's in Murray, for another thing it's in Gordon. And I regret to me to see a lot of Bamshire no longer in existence. Well, I've been 22 years here. I'm sure some of you think I've been 22 years too long. I've enjoyed these years, and again, the great cooperation in the town of everyone. And here I would particularly like to mention our fellow clergy in the town, the city, in the town of Keith. The bond that has been with us throughout the years. These are very, very special memories to me. So tonight, these are all the things that are going through my mind. Very happy 50 years. And I would like to thank all those people, and you people as well, who have made it possible.
Chairman, to present Monsignor a small token of our affection, respect, and thanks for the work he's done in this momentous year for the Legion. John.
Thank you, John. On behalf of the Royal Legion, would you like to present this for the Divine Spurs?
Somewhere, will he tell us what it is? Jack?
Yeah.
Down at that end, or you'll hear him from here, he's got a good voice.
I don't know what to do. If I stumble on this.
Shh.
If I stumble on this, blame it on the very neat writing here, which is rather crashed in, but I'll do my best. And I didn't see this until I got here tonight. 50 years of service to church and fellow man takes a bit of matching. Very few folk can. Though church is all-consuming, if I found a time for more, how many anxious people have knocked upon your door? You've always found the time to do the work that others shun, and once you start, we know for sure we'll see a job well done. So, John. Accept our heartfelt thanks, although at times we know our deep appreciation is very slow to show. May you go on for many years, but take as well as give. You've earned a deep contentment and shown us how to live. Well done.
Thank you very much, Jack Cree. Now, the last thing, and I hope your glasses are all ready for this, is to raise your glasses and to wish continued good health, many more happy years among us, not only as our parish priest, but also as our very good friends. Monsignor John Copland.
Monsignor John Copland.
It was suggested that we sing, those of us who can sing, for those of us who know the words, and waltz our sound.
Ad multos annos vivat, glorimus quae annos vivat, ad multos annos, glorimus quae annos vivat, vivat, vivat.
Bless us, O Lord, and these thy gifts, which we are about to receive from thy bounty, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
This copier for tonight's entertainment, it is with great pleasure that I now introduce to you the artists. could you welcome on stage on keyboard Jane Farmerson, of course, State Thomas's church organist herself, Jane. Thank you. And to accompany Jane, of course, on accordion, the one and only Mr. Ian Cruikshank. Please. Monsignor Copland's Golden Jubilee Jig. That was a tune. Thank you. And we'd like to invite Monsignor Copland onto the stage at this point. Ladies and gentlemen, round of applause, please. Thank you. And to carry on the proceedings, Jane, could you take the floor? Thank you. Monsignor Copland, a few words. Here we are.
I think you have enough from me already, but this is really a wonderful gift. Thank you very, very much indeed, Trevor.
Thank you. Monsignor Copland's Golden Jubilee Jig. And that's a signed copy, framed copy, composed, written, and performed tonight for the first time by Ian. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. So could you continue, Ian, another reselection? Quick key. The one and only Frank McNally singing to you tonight some traditional songs. Frank.
Well, thank you, Marty. My first song tonight is one which I'm sure Monsignor Copland will appreciate because it's one of his favourites. It's The Bonnie Lass of Ballachmyle.
Oh,
sure you'll appreciate it will bring back a lot of memories of your days in the Cairn Gardens. That off the guard.
list of votes of thanks. I think perhaps if just let me get them all in, and then show your appreciation at the end, it will save us a bit of time. First, our pastoral council, your previous places, they've all worked and contributed.
It was a big mistake. That's the worst kept secret of the world. I don't think anyone might, if I mentioned personally,
if I mentioned personally Joe and Betty, the evidence of their work's been everywhere tonight. And I would also like to say thank you to Mrs. Barry for the lovely kitchen. And again, a great thanks to them for the contribution of the jig, which was all of them. Earlier on this week, end of last week and earlier on this week, there was work still going on in the new disabled toilets, which are not even completed. And the hall was quite frankly a shambles. Now, look round it now. It's shining clean from roof, walls, floor, and I give credit to those who have done the enormous amount of hard work to get it into that state in a matter of days. They've been working far into the night. In fact, we were here last night about 11 o'clock, and I think a hall keeper actually kicked us out about that time. It's wonderful. One also little vote of thanks, and this is a very personal one to my son-in-law David Lloyd, who produced the pillars that you see at the front of the church, an attempt to disguise the scaffolding and make it look a bit more like a temple, perhaps, but to David Lloyd. And we have to thank all our special guests, Monsignor's own particular relatives and friends, the clergy from all our Keith churches, and it's a sheer delight to see them joining us, not only in our prayers, but in the fun we have afterwards. To my fellow knights, Jim and Ron, and to particularly Bishop Conti and Cardinal Winning. They've made such a difference. I thank all who have contributed in any way to this Jubilee celebration who have not been personally thanked. I know it's impossible to go over everybody, and that's always a problem. But lastly, as a certain gentleman used to put it at the end of one of his concerts, to yourselves. If you had not been here, it wouldn't have been much of a party, would it? Now, we have one more thing to do. To complete the proceedings, Monsignor is going to lead us out into the night to a tune that his fellow priests have particularly dedicated to him. Why, I don't know, but I would suspect the hand somewhere of a certain high dignitary who ought to be nameless. Over now to Jake.